My name is Kelly Longo-Albaran, and I'm the Government Affairs Associate for the Public Policy Institute of California. Thank you all for joining us here today. For those of you who aren't familiar with PPIC, we are a nonprofit, nonpartisan think tank based in San Francisco with offices here in Sacramento. Today's event is part of the James Irvine Foundation, so we'd like to say thank you to them, Foundation Briefing Series. On your chair, you should have found the report that we'll be talking about today, titled Health Coverage and Care for Undocumented Immigrants. We have the two authors up here, and also the co-authors, Joe Hayes and Laura Hill, in the audience, and they'll be available for questions afterwards. The report and the slides that you're about to see are actually already up online, so feel free to take a look at those. And just a couple quick things, we actually have a big event. I see some people who are here who are already signed up for it for next Thursday. We actually are already full. It's called Governing in a Time of Change, but feel free to sign up to watch it online. Also later today, you'll receive an email with a short survey. We ask that you take a few moments to fill it out and let us know how we did so we can improve. And of course, please silence or turn off your cell phones. Just take an extra look at that. So, and now I'd like to introduce our speakers. Shannon McConville is a research associate whose research interests include healthcare access, utilization, and outcomes among vulnerable populations. And Iwunze, who we'll hear from first, is also a research associate. His work focuses on K-12 education, specifically pertaining to high needs populations. When they're finished, we'll open it up to audience Q&A. And with that, we'll get started. Iwunze.
All right, well, hi everyone. My name is Iwunze Ugo, and I'm a research associate at PPIC. And today, I, along with my colleague, Shannon McConville, will be discussing today's report titled Health Coverage and Care for Undocumented Immigrants. I'll begin with a brief summary of the ways in which California has been a leader in extending various policies to cover the state's large population of undocumented immigrants. In order to manage these policy expansions, we need good information about the undocumented population throughout the state. And I'll talk a bit about the efforts to obtain this information, including the methods that we use in this report. From there, I'll turn it over to Shannon, who will describe the various efforts to expand healthcare coverage to this population and how our research can better inform that process. She'll then continue on to talk about the future of policy in this area. Going back to the beginning, I want to talk about something that's sometimes called the California package. As the federal government has long stalled on immigration reform to address the 11 million undocumented living in the country, states have taken it upon themselves to craft their own policies for this group. Some states have been restrictive, while others, like California, have expanded various policies to offer accommodations to all of its residents, regardless of their citizenship status. In 2001, the legislature passed AB 540, which allowed undocumented students who had attended California colleges or California high schools to pay in-state tuition. The California Dream Act, which was passed in the form of two bills in 2011, further expanded access to higher education by allowing undocumented students to apply for scholarships and state-funded financial aid. AB 60, which was passed in 2013, further has allowed 513,000 undocumented immigrants to obtain driver's licenses, and the law passed in 2014 requires all 40 of the state's occupational licensing boards to consider applicants regardless of their citizenship status. In healthcare, recent budgets have called for funding to extend full-scope Medi-Cal coverage to low-income undocumented children, and Shannon will discuss the current efforts to expand this coverage even further. Now, in order to best manage these policy expansions, policymakers need good information on undocumented immigrants throughout the state. Of course, this information is hard to come by since there are some strong incentives for people to shield their citizenship status from the state's various data collection efforts. Also, almost no surveys ask about documentation status, and even if they did, they wouldn't be very likely to receive reliable answers due to those same incentives. And so the size of the undocumented population is often estimated. Large-scale estimates of the undocumented population, like the ones done at the Pew Hispanic Center, often rely on what's called the residual method. This is done by starting with census data on foreign-born residents and, in a sense, working backwards, eliminating different groups that are likely to be legal residents and then assuming that the remainder is undocumented. The Center for Migration Studies recently estimated that there are about 2.67 million undocumented immigrants in California. Now, these estimates are often reasonable at the national or state level, though they aren't precise enough to be reliably estimate populations at smaller levels like counties. At these smaller levels, some estimates simply rely on using larger sample sizes for their surveys, while others conduct surveys in one place like Los Angeles and then extend those results to apply to the entire undocumented population in California. In this report, however, we take the unique approach of using administrative data. The IRS issues what's called individual taxpayer identification numbers, or ITINs, to tax filers who don't have Social Security numbers. This group includes foreign gamblers and visiting professors, among others, but is overwhelmingly made up of undocumented immigrants. We use this data to provide more precise estimates of the population of undocumented immigrants in California as a whole, as well as throughout regions across the state. The ITIN data is very useful to us for a number of reasons. The data is collected at the zip code level, so we at PPIC have been able to provide estimates of the undocumented population in California at an unprecedented level of granularity. Another way this data is so useful is that, being tax data, it contains a lot of the information that you'd expect to see on a tax form. Things like marital status, the use of benefits like the child tax credit, and of course, income. We're able to use this data to come up with estimates of both family sizes and incomes, which are key to understanding just how many people these policy expansions could serve, particularly how many of the undocumented have incomes below 138% of the federal poverty line, which is the eligibility threshold for Medi-Cal coverage. Shifting back a bit to the population estimates, we see at 2.67 million, California has the largest undocumented population of any state in the country, with nearly a quarter of the nation's undocumented residing here. The undocumented live in every region of the state, but Los Angeles County has far more than any other. There are also substantial populations of undocumented immigrants in Orange County, Santa Clara, and San Diego. Now, again, since the ITIN data goes all the way down to the zip code level, we're able to go beyond just talking about the total undocumented population in regions and counties across the state. Going zip code by zip code, we can see that although Los Angeles does have the highest total overall undocumented population, individual communities throughout the Central Valley tend to have some of the highest shares of undocumented residents. I'll now turn it over to Shannon for more on the issue of healthcare coverage.
Thanks, Iwunze. So now in the presentation, we're going to turn to focus more on the healthcare coverage discussions that have been going on at the state capitol in recent years. As I'm sure many of you know, undocumented immigrants were largely excluded from the coverage expansions that were under the Affordable Care Act, or the ACA, or Obamacare. And as a result, the undocumented make up a sizable share of California residents that continue to not have health insurance coverage. So first, we're going to start with some information on what the current landscape of coverage and access to care looks like for undocumented residing in California. So first, some undocumented immigrants do have private health insurance coverage, most often through employers. Again, sources of information for this group are limited. However, national estimates suggest somewhere between 30 and 40% of undocumented immigrants likely do have private sources of insurance coverage. Another relatively small group of undocumented in the state do have access to comprehensive public insurance coverage through the Medi-Cal program. So this would include those undocumented residents who successfully registered for the DACA program and achieved deferred action status. Under current Medi-Cal program, if they are income eligible, they are eligible to receive Medi-Cal benefits. The most recent estimate we have from the Department of Homeland Security suggests about 195,000 have successfully registered for DACA. And so again, among those who would be income eligible, they could receive Medi-Cal benefits under current policy. And with, as Iwunze mentioned, with the most recent state budget, undocumented children under the age of 19 will become eligible for comprehensive Medi-Cal benefits next year. But the majority of undocumented immigrants in the state do not have comprehensive health insurance coverage. As a result, they rely on our healthcare safety net providers, predominantly community clinics, hospital emergency departments, to access medical care when they do need it. And then there are also a patchwork of other limited programs that are open to undocumented residents, none of which are equivalent to full health benefits. So these include limited benefits. Sometimes they're referred to as state-only programs. An example of this is Family Pact, which provides reproductive health services. There's also what we call limited scope Medi-Cal or emergency only Medi-Cal. So that does provide some financial assistance, again, for emergency services to the undocumented population. Much of the costs, or much of what's covered there, at least in the current state, is labor and delivery for undocumented pregnant women. And then finally, counties are tasked with providing care to uninsured residents through what we call county indigent care programs. And so, although all counties are required to provide care to their medically indigent residents and operate an indigent care program, counties do have considerable flexibility in determining who is eligible for those programs and the level of services that they do provide. This flexibility does include the decision to limit coverage based on legal status. And while several large counties, most often those that operate public hospital systems, do include the undocumented and do provide some services through their county indigent care programs, several other counties do not. So here what we show is the first bar in the figure shows the total count of undocumented immigrants who live in counties that cover health services and cover the undocumented regardless of immigration status. You can see this first bar, so nearly half are in Los Angeles County. And also most counties in the Bay Area also do provide some services to the undocumented. I would also note that this figure does reflect recent policy changes made by Sacramento County and the 35 smaller counties that contract with the CMSP program to provide indigent care services. So just recently those counties in the CMSP program have changed their policy and now will include at least some services for undocumented residents. But according to our estimates, our county estimates, about 900,000 undocumented live in counties where they are not eligible for indigent care. That's the second bar here. The large majority of those are in the Southern California. And one last thing I'll note is that these totals don't reflect other eligibility criteria that counties may impose in order to qualify for indigent care. This could include income or asset tests. And so this is just based on whether they cover undocumented immigrants. And so now it's important to again emphasize that indigent care and safety net resources and some of these other limited programs that we're talking about, while they are clearly a critical access point for people to gain access to needed medical care, they are not equivalent to having comprehensive health insurance. Coverage that covers a full range of medical services and also can be provided across regions, across delivery systems. And so to address the lack of affordable coverage options for the undocumented, there are a few current policy options that are under discussion or under debate that could expand those possibilities. So first, there are two possible pathways for Medi-Cal coverage to expand to low-income, income-eligible adults. The first would be if federal immigration executive action is allowed to move forward in the courts. So this is the expansion of the DACA program and also a new program, the Deferred Action for Parental Accountability, DAPA. That could open up a larger group of undocumented immigrants could register for deferred action status, and under California state policy, those with deferred action status are eligible for Medi-Cal. The state has also signaled, at least through the past budget discussions, that they will continue to provide coverage to those under deferred action status. One last point here is also work permits that could come with these programs could improve opportunities for jobs that may also provide employer-based insurance coverage benefits. And then second, the state legislature has, in the last few legislative sessions, sought to expand coverage opportunities for the undocumented through the state. And so that includes full Medi-Cal benefits for those with qualifying incomes to undocumented adults. It was this legislation that, as it continued along, has now provided coverage for undocumented children in the state starting next year. And then for those with higher incomes, the proposals are to allow undocumented immigrants to purchase plans through the state's health insurance marketplace, Covered California. This would require the state to seek a federal waiver to allow the undocumented to be able to just purchase plans. And under current proposals, there would be no financial assistance. So about 90% of all people who currently purchase plans through Covered California do receive premium subsidies. Under the current proposals, the undocumented would be able to purchase plans, but there would be no financial assistance. And then finally, comprehensive immigration reform that provides a pathway to legal residency and citizenship would also open up opportunities for affordable health insurance coverage. And so to help inform all of these discussions and debates, we estimated the number of undocumented immigrants based on poverty thresholds used to determine both Medi-Cal eligibility and also higher poverty thresholds that are used by Covered California to determine levels of financial assistance. And so from that, what we find is statewide, over half of undocumented immigrants, almost 1.4 million of California's undocumented immigrants, have incomes that would likely qualify them for Medi-Cal should coverage be extended. So again, Iwunze, I believe, mentioned that the Medi-Cal eligibility threshold is 138% of the federal poverty level. That translates to about $33,500 for a family of four. And so we also, again, did cutoffs at slightly higher income levels. Another 36% of the undocumented statewide have incomes above the Medi-Cal threshold, but below 250% of the federal poverty level. This is about $60,000 for a family of four. So still relatively low income, but would be above qualifying for the Medi-Cal program. And then finally, the last two much smaller pieces of the pie are those above 250%, and then those above 400% of the poverty level. And currently under California, 400% is the cutoff to receive financial subsidies, and so it's a very small share of the undocumented are above that. So we also wanted to develop regional estimates of poverty levels because so much of healthcare provision and insurance markets really are at a regional level. We wanted to include information about that. In addition, if undocumented were able to enroll in the Medi-Cal program, they would most likely go into Medi-Cal managed care plans. These two are at a county or regional level. So we wanted to provide some estimates that were at a sub-state level. So the methods we use, which Iwunze discussed, to estimate poverty levels require us to group counties into regions so that we have enough information. Some of these counties are large enough to do it, and in others we need to group several counties together. We chose to define regions according to the insurance pricing regions that are currently used by Covered California, which represent insurance markets, and in many cases also correspond to Medi-Cal managed care delivery plans. What you can see here from the map, so the darker shaded areas are where a higher share of undocumented immigrants likely have incomes below 138% and would likely qualify for the Medi-Cal program should it be expanded. So again, you see Los Angeles County, parts of the Central Valley, around 60% of undocumented immigrants, according to our estimates, would fall below that Medi-Cal poverty threshold. This compares to the Bay Area, where we do see higher income levels. Around 40% of undocumented immigrants in most of the counties in the Bay Area would likely would be eligible for Medi-Cal, but then that leaves the 60% who would be above the Medi-Cal threshold level. And so, you know, again, we also took a look at those different cutoffs across regions. And so that's what this is. This chart shows the different poverty threshold breakdowns in regions with the highest number of undocumented immigrants. So all of these regions we're showing here, which are along the bottom, have at least 100,000 undocumented immigrants residing in those areas. The orange bar corresponds to the below 138%, which is what we just showed on that map. The dark and light blue bars are those other poverty categories, and then the purple portion is the share above 400%. I would note here too, 400% of the federal poverty level is about $97,000 in annual income for a family of four. So you see similar trends. Many undocumented above the Medi-Cal threshold still have fairly low income. So this is similar to what we see at the state level. Although again, you can see in Los Angeles, the Inland Empire, parts of the Central Valley, very few undocumented immigrants are above 250%, so it's still a relatively low income group. And then in some areas of Southern California, Orange, San Diego, and some of the Bay Area counties, you do see a larger share that are at these higher income levels. And so for those with income levels above the Medi-Cal threshold, as I mentioned, there is proposals to allow them to access health plans that are sold on Covered California. And so under the ACA, the undocumented are prohibited from purchasing those plans. But again, the state could seek a waiver to allow the undocumented to do that. And so what we did here is we used the 2016 Covered California Shop and Compare tool, and we wanted to see what those costs might look like without financial assistance. This shows the monthly premium amount and the percent of income it would take to purchase a bronze or silver plan. This example is for a family of four. This would be two adults, two undocumented adults, age 35, and two children, with a monthly income of about $4,000. A monthly income of that amount would translate to about 200% of the federal poverty level, so above being eligible for Medi-Cal, but still in a relatively low-income group. Under the Affordable Care Act, they did endeavor to create affordability standards. That's how they decided how much income people should pay for coverage. So a family at 200% of the federal level, according to the ACA, it would be 6.3% of their income should go to cover insurance premiums. And so what we see here, for example, in Monterey County, which is one of the higher priced regions in the state in California, a family of four paying full price, the monthly premium would be $562 for a bronze plan, $741 a month, which translates between 15 and 20% of their total income would need to be spent on insurance premiums. And I'll note too, with a bronze plan, I don't know how familiar you are with the tiers of the plans, the bronze plan still does require a fair amount of cost sharing amongst people who are in that plan. So in addition to these monthly premiums, there would also be financial outlays at the point of access for care. And so I'll also note, we chose just a handful of counties both to illustrate the range of costs across the state in insurance. Also, all four of these counties do not provide services under their county indigent programs to undocumented immigrants. And so just finally to wrap up, looking forward, there is still, existing in the state a large group of undocumented immigrants who do not have access to affordable coverage options. And so, as I mentioned, there are legislative proposals and other places where they're trying to expand potential coverage options. In the absence of those reforms moving forward, it really is our healthcare safety net providers that are responsible for being a point of access and providing needed medical care. Again, I had mentioned these are community clinics, our hospital emergency departments, our public hospital systems, and so it's important that they still receive the financial resources that they need in order to provide care to all Californians. There is a kind of movement, there's the good research studies that have come out recently where expanded coverage has been linked to several positive outcomes. These include lower mortality rates, improved educational and employment outcomes for children, and also public opinion. We've seen several polls in the last year that have suggested that there is support in moving some of these proposals forward. And finally, without comprehensive immigration reform at the federal level, California, and as Iwunze mentioned, will likely continue to lead the way in trying to provide some amount of benefits and other services to this large group of residents in the state. And the expansion of Medi-Cal to California's children, at least in the health coverage domain, is a big first step in that direction. And with that, we'll open it up for questions. And if you could please wait for the microphone to ask your question, that would be great. Iwunze is going to come back up.
I have a question about the expanded coverage for children. Mm-hmm. Will that include behavioral health, or as it used to be called, mental health? Will it include dentistry, eyeglasses?
Yes. So at least on the behavioral health side, the Affordable Care Act did extend, Medi-Cal has always covered some amount of behavioral health. Under the ACA, there is a broader coverage, which does also apply to Medi-Cal, which does broaden the coverage and access to behavioral health services, mental health, and substance use disorder services. So yes, through the Medi-Cal program, there should be an expansion of access to those services. Dental children under Medi-Cal do have dental coverage. When the state did make the choice to take away dental coverage due to budgetary concerns, it was adults. It did stay available for children. So yes.
It's my understanding, or I think you just mentioned that that the ACA bars undocumented immigrants or from accessing Medi-Cal, or they're not eligible for the Medi-Cal expansion, I guess. So my question is, what does all this cost? And do you have any policy recommendations on how to pay for it?
I don't necessarily have policy recommendations on how to pay for it. In large part, I think that's part of the legislative and administrative process in understanding, you know, budget trade-offs and those sorts of things. But you're absolutely right. And the federal government not paying for Medicaid for the undocumented is a longstanding policy. It's not just for the ACA. It was pre-ACA, but then with the Affordable Care Act largely expanding Medi-Cal coverage to a much broader group of low-income adults, it was explicit again that the undocumented were not included. But yes, the cost is something that I think everyone is working on, and that is probably one of the big things in trying to understand how these different proposals can move forward. If I will say there are some folks out there who I think have developed those estimates, and I'd be happy to talk with you afterwards if you'd like to get pointed to those.
Hi. In regards to the slide you showed with the kind of the color map of people being most concentrated in the Central Valley, yeah, that one. I'd read some early reports with the implementation of the Affordable Care Act about an increased surge of emergency department visits, specifically in the Central Valley. And then, but anecdotally, I've heard reports in some primary underserved community clinics and university-run clinics, a decrease in attendance after the implementation of the Affordable Care Act. Did you, in your research, come across any association with kind of surges in people coming into the emergency departments or these primary care clinics, whether they're more undocumented people or people kind of accessing new affordable care abilities?
Right. So I have taken a look. Emergency department is another area of work that I'm interested in. I have taken a look at least at the statewide numbers in terms of 2014, what emergency department utilization looked like. I think there was a big concern that with the influx of just those in Medi-Cal, so this isn't the undocumented, this is just the large increase in the number of people covered by Medi-Cal, that emergency departments could be high hit. Medi-Cal or Medicaid, it's true across the country, have the highest visit rates at emergency departments. And so I think there was that concern. When I took a look at the statewide numbers, there was an increase, but it was in line with the increasing trend that we've seen the last 5 years in the total number of emergency department encounters. That's not in specific areas or at specific hospitals or regions. I could imagine there could be that. And I think that was one of a policy concern with the Medi-Cal expansion broadly, so not around the undocumented. In past work we've done, we actually find the undocumented do use emergency departments because there is they are required to provide necessary medical care regardless of ability to pay, insurance coverage status, or immigration status under federal law. So it is a point of access, although in most of the work that I've done and others have done, you actually see non-citizens and the undocumented specifically use care less. So they do tend to wait, and I think for some of the reasons maybe Iwunze talked about, it's not as if they flood emergency departments. But given that is one place that does have to care for them and care for them at a high level, if they need that, it is an important point of access. But it'll be good, the figures on emergency department use for 2014 are available, and we can start drilling down into more regional, into hospitals, and see what might be going on.
In addition to what it costs, I think it would be interesting to frame it, what do we save when we think of reduction of emergency use, a reduction of incarceration, and when we think of the advantages of community wellness. So I hope we also look at that question as well in our research.
Right. I think it's a good point, and I think the frame of, you know, there are already financial resources, both by hospital delivery systems, but also the state and the monies that they provide to counties for indigent care and the monies they provide to, say, public hospital systems and through the emergency Medi-Cal. So there is a pot of money that is going to this care, and why not, rather than have it be on an episodic, emergent basis, have it be funding care that is primary care, preventative care, trying to keep people out of emergency departments. So I think it's a fair point, and I think in the proposals that have been moving forward, that is clearly one of the frames of trying when we think about this.
California is kind of living in a golden age right now in terms of acceptance of immigration and even limited acceptance of illegal immigration. But if you know California history, you know the backlash is right under the surface. Mm-hmm. Is anybody measuring how much we can push this envelope without backlash taking place?
I don't know of that. I mean, I think for me, the place you look to try to understand that would be in the number of public opinion polling that we do in the state. And at least, you know, you're right, the history, the things do move back and forth, although it does, recent polling and over the last few years, the trend seems to be continuing to move upward in terms of support. And so, at least in terms of the trend over the last several years, that does seem to be where we're moving. In terms of a specific group or research organization that is looking at that, I don't know. But I do think kind of your public opinion, your polling organizations, and there are plenty of them in California, including PPIC, does show kind of, you know, trending support, and that's been happening over the last several years.
Hi. Gil O'Heather, how are you doing?
Just fine, how are you?
All right. There was just the report that was released today, I think in Healthline, that recorded the opinion of the population, it was evenly split, 46-46. There was 46% support of coverage for the undocumented, 46% against, and the other percentage, I don't know. So I think the work that the field poll has done with PPIC has kind of showed that evolution over the last 3 years. And I believe that poll is actually from you guys.
We had a poll recently, I know, and I think the numbers were higher than that. I also know that the Wellness Foundation funded a poll that came out a month or two ago, and I think in that poll the number was closer to 60 or 70%. I'm not familiar with the one that you just mentioned, but yeah, I mean, PPIC has been asking, you know, we have a long history of polling, and they have been asking questions about undocumented immigrants and health coverage the last few years, and it has been an increasing trend. The exact numbers I don't have handy, but no, I think it's a good point to make.
And I just want to note also, the Center for Labor Research and Education has also done some estimates, probably the best estimates, on the actual cost.
The UC Berkeley, that's exactly right. So the UC Berkeley Labor Center, along with UCLA, Center for Health Policy Studies, that's exactly right. They have some simulation models, and they have done some of those reports. Thank you.
Hi, can you speak a little bit to the capacity of both the safety net and the Medi-Cal providers in these places that we see have very high rates of unmet need? I was in a meeting with Fresno County just yesterday talking about the influx of newly enrolled legal residents in... Sorry, I'm making Siri go off with my question. That those providers are really swamped, and there's long waits, and people have trouble actually accessing the care even though they are enrolled. I wonder if you could speak to either emerging trends in research or who's looking at that kind of intersection.
Right. I think that is a big, you know, with the influx, and it was a larger influx than I think anyone necessarily expected in terms of the numbers that have enrolled in Medi-Cal since coverage was expanded in January 2014. And I do think that was a concern before any of this happened. Can the safety net providers, I mean, because that's the thing, safety net providers don't just provide care to the uninsured. They provide they're a large provider of care to the publicly insured, and seemingly that's not changing. They continue community clinics, I think, saw an increase in the number of visits they were encountering. Their payer mix is shifting. More folks that were uninsured are now covered under Medi-Cal, but they are still accessing care there. You know, I think there's a lot of work being done at the state level. I think, you know, across the board, Medi-Cal managed care plans are trying to understand how they can improve their networks and their capacity to do this. I think the state is working with them to try to, you know, whether that revolves around reimbursement rates or other ways in which they can support them. But I think it's also important that everyone keeps in mind, you know, and I think it does, you know, the recent 1115 waiver and different things like that, but trying to really provide support to our safety net system, our public hospital systems, who, as you make the good point, they serve the Medi-Cal population. Now at 12 million and more counting is who's providing, you know, coverage to a large group of those. And so I think that is important. And a lot of times we do focus on coverage, you know, insurance coverage. This is coverage. And really the next, you know, why coverage is important is because it should give you better access and less, you know, financial stress, but you should be able to access care. And so I think that is kind of the next wave of where people will focus, is ensuring that the provider networks that we have under Medi-Cal and in these managed care plans can handle the influx, you know. And so we keep seeing more, you know, under the Affordable Care Act, and then if you know, if these things change. I mean, that said, the capacity is likely there. It's a matter of trying to figure out the best way to deliver it. And I think that's really happening right now at the local level, trying to understand how to change their models and how to, you know, use medical teams. And, you know, there's a lot innovating throughout the healthcare delivery system to try to understand how they can best provide care and provide access. Yeah, thanks so much. Thank you for coming.